everybody. Welcome back to the repeat, my channel, I suppose. It is currently 11:46 a.m. on the 11th of December, in case you wanted to know that for some reason. Before I start the game, I just have to say a few things. I don't know if you know this about me, but back in 2018, along with becoming a furry and joining all the furry VN shit, I also found a channel by the name of this honored wolf, and well, he's no longer on the internet whatsoever. He, like, left for mental health and his mental, like, stability and all that shit. His friends, Mahler and Rags, have been doing a podcast ever since then, and I basically watched all of their content that I felt I wanted to watch. I just love their content in general, and I've been watching EFAP's started as well. We're now like 211 or something at this point, episode-wise. There's so many memories, man. There's so many memories of these people that I've never fucking met, making me laugh and smile and just... Yeah, anyway, that's not a song about. What I was talking about was, as you all know, hopefully, God of War Ragnarok came out recently, and I was not the biggest fan of the first game. In fact, I hated the first game. It was bad. Like, I love the story. The story for the first game was great, but the gameplay was atrocious. Was terrible. I even still, I vastly prefer the original game's gameplay style to this. You don't have a RE4 style POV when you're playing a God of War game. You just fucking don't. But in Ragnarok, the story is built upon 2018 exponentially, and the gameplay is improved a lot from what I've seen. The gameplay with Atreus in particular, because he's mainly like a shooter type character, his the sections with him when you're fighting are way more fun. From what I've seen online, it's just like, because the camera was built for a shooter. It was built for, like, third-person shooters, so it makes a lot of sense why it's working like that. Anyway, EFAF covered a video. That's every frame pause. Basically, they covered a video last night, and I never watched the streams live because I don't like the chat, and the chat genuinely drives me up the fucking wall. So I started watching it today, and I had to stop because I was listening to the person they were covering being a complete scumbag, like, oh, I'm such a alpha male, I'm so masculine, you're using an effeminate twink profile picture. Fucking Christ, man. It was like Marceline or something, and I've never seen it. I'm not really a big fan of Adventure Time. Wasn't really as a kid because I wasn't able to watch it. But wow, that's not an argument. Not to mention him bringing up the old console wars debate again, and it was just disgusting. And then seeing the chat, like, saying, oh my god, leave him alone, he's done nothing wrong. Yeah, no, I seriously think that Mahler's fan base has turned into a bunch of bad people. It has been 3 minutes and I'm yammering on about this garbage. Let's get into the fucking game already. What one is it? It's the 8th. Yeah, it's the 8th. Right. The next morning was a complete blur. I vaguely remember crawling out of bed like a slug and tumbling onto the floor with Sissel in a tangle of limbs. There was shouting, half-awake grumbles, and an agitated Herschel dragging us out of the bathroom because he urgently needed to pee. At some point, the fear of being late and disappointment with Scurly struck me like the wrath of God. Immediately booked it back to Granny Academy in a mad dash with Sissel waving drowsily as I disappeared down the street. You have not been in this fucking class. You've not been in this fucking school in fucking days, dude. Wow. It turned out I didn't need to bother. Mr. Rakoushnikov was teaching writing workshop again with that insufferable level of enthusiasm that should be illegal at this hour of the day. I don't know about that. He was addressing the class with such vigor that he didn't even notice me shuffling in 20 minutes late. Sank into a seat in the back with a sigh. Looks like it's another one of those classes where we just listen to Mr. Rakoushnikov talk to himself for an hour. At least I didn't miss out on anything. Well, someone's been busy, Oh boy, I have this dude jumped and glanced behind me at Philip's deadpan face. Stared back with a dull thumbs up. Looks like not even a bookworm Philip was immune to how boring Mr. Rakeshnikov's classes were. Blinked and stared a little closer. There were heavy bags under Philip's eyes, and he looked like he hadn't been sleeping well. Though he was doing all right. No way, Philip. Sorry I haven't been around lately. Life's been stressful. Philip raised an eyebrow suspiciously. Stressful. Frantic text I've been getting from Sissel this morning says otherwise. The kind of texts? Philip smiled knowingly as he put through his phone for a few moments before handing it to me. Okay, that's really funny. That's fucking hilarious. It was a message roommate made by Sissel labeled the Mom Friends, consisting of just Jenny and Philip. Messages from earlier this morning read, "Oh boy. Holy shit, guys, I think I might have fucked up." Probably, but you'll have to be more specific. Well, last night I accidentally slept with Alex.
Really?
Yeah.
You accidentally slept with Alex.
Yes.
Accidentally.
Yes.
I don't understand. Did you trip or something?
No, he was staying over and we had only one bed and shit.
Isn't this a good thing? You've been trying to ask him out for the past week.
Skips what he did in steps, though. What if he thinks I'm just a horn dog and not serious about this?
Pause and scroll through the chat's history. Earlier parts were littered with an abundance of Sissel pleading for dating advice. That's fucking cute. Jenny wisely suggested give it a lap. Cover yourself in chocolate and pop out of a cake naked. What the fuck, dude?
Philip, on the other hand, just wrote, talk to him, you know, like a normal person.
Wow, thank you.
Someone's actually smart.
Damn, sounds like you guys were busier than I was. He wouldn't stop fussing over you like a mother hen. It's kind of sweet, like in a diabetes sort of way. Oh, it's thoughtful of him, at least.
No, Stinny hasn't replied recently. I figured she'd jump at this kind of thing. You guys told Owen about this too? Philip frowned.
Jenny's probably sleeping in. She hasn't been feeling very well lately.
And Owen went home yesterday to deal with some family shit. Says he's coming back soon, though. For now, it's just little old me here.
Anywho, I think you should message this one and let him know the world isn't ending before he blows up our phones again.
Alrighty, thanks for the advice, old dating expert.
I mean, true, he's literally the only one that in that text chat that actually, you know, gave genuine advice that wasn't fucking ridiculous. Jenny over there being a fucking idiot with, oh yes, just do abruptly sexual things for no fucking reason and hope that doesn't scare him off. Whereas Phillips just said, like, talk to him. Fucking talk to the person. Just talk.
Yeah. And it back Phillips out with a sheepish grin. Word sure spread fast and green, yeah.
No, it doesn't. That implies that everyone in the fucking school knows about this. They don't.
It'll be a while before Mr. Kashnikov stopped his lecture and that no one was listening. No one was listening to. Plenty of time to message Sissel to see how he was doing. Grab my phone again, texting Sissel on my desk discreetly. Hey, sis, how's your morning? Second thought, he might be busy with work at the cafe right now. Maybe I should hold off a while.
The morning, I'll just make it back to campus, all right.
Yep, back in Boronon Rakeshnikov's class. I should have just slept in a little bit more. By the way, Philip, show me your mom friend's messaging group. Pause and watch the Sissel is typing. Oh no. I hate that. Propped cycle random down my screen.
That little shit twat wasn't supposed to tell anyone.
Aw, don't worry too much about it. It was really sweet to see a fuss over me.
Wasn't supposed to see any of that. This is embarrassing.
Hey, now, I saw your messages this morning and wanted to tell you that everything's fine. Pretty happy with how last night went. So calm your buns and stay happy. You're doing great.
Say so. Wait, shouldn't you be in class right now?
Nobody actually pays attention, Mr. Kaushtikov. What about you? Shouldn't you be opening up the cafe? Okay, for those of you who are really confused why I'm like saying, why I'm calling and why I'm like doing that, Rakashikaze at a row cop, it's because
Here's a Russian accent that I gave him, and Kaushnikov in literature is from Dostoevsky, and I love his work, so I'm going to use that name for this dude. For those who have apparently wish seen that, whatever. We're gonna multitask, and there aren't any customers at the moment anyway. Looked up at my phone and glanced at the clock. Groan immediately escaped my throat. Just another half hour until Mr. Kashnikov's adult lecture was over. Hey, says your soon-to-be boyfriend slash date, can I ask you for a favor?
Doris, what do you want?
Tell me an interesting story. I'm gonna need something to pass the time or the boredom's gonna kill me.
Shouldn't you be paying attention in the class?
Mr. Kashnikov was going on about what his granddaughter ate for breakfast. If I don't get any entertainment anytime soon, I'll die. Like, for real.
Drama queen, all right, I'll tell you a darn story. Can't say I'm good as Owen at telling ridiculous tales, though.
I could listen to you talk for hours. Oh my fucking god, really? Fucking apostrophe three. Kill me now.
So damn cheesy. Well, I guess I can tell you the story how I got my tattoo.
Oh yeah, I've been wondering about that. How'd you afford a tattoo when you were living on the streets for so long? That wasn't my first question. My first question was, what does it represent? But okay. Fucking Christ.
Well, I got my tattoo around the time I was 15. Boss recently won a lottery ticket for like $500, and then he gave about 100 to me, and pretty much said, treat yourself. Worked out for Boss for a while, and was pretty much my hero, so I wanted a tattoo on my shoulder just like his. Too young to get without parents' permission, and I didn't exactly have parents to get permission from, so obviously got myself a fake ID.
Wait, you're kidding, right? You got a fake ID.
Well, wasn't the one who got it. Jenny said she knew a guy who owed her a favor, and the next day she just shoved a fake ID into my hands. So real and everything, I thought it was ugly as hell, though.
All ID photos are required by law to be ugly. Mine is fucking ugly.
Wouldn't be surprised. Anyway, Teach said that in return for getting me that darn thing, she wanted to be there when I got my tattoo. Next thing I knew, the two of us rocking in the tattoo shop, and of course, shit went wrong.
What happened?
Well, the artist lady in charge of the shop turned out to be part of Mr. Curly's knitting circle. You'd bet your ass she'd snitch on us, we just pretended we were looking around then booked it out of there. Figured we'd better look mature that tape parlor in the next town, so Teach called that guy who owed her a favor again. He drove us there in his dinky ass car. That was pretty scary and shitty, to be honest. He had these eyes like a hawk that could stare straight into your fucking soul. Really nice once I got to know him, though. He even gave me his number and told me to call him if I was stuck in a bad place.
This is a lot for a fucking text. I'm just gonna say it. He must be typing extremely fucking fast. Stare at my phone doubtfully. It's awfully kind of him.
No, right? No idea how Teach knows so many good people. Anyway, the three of us piled into this dinky little car, and the dude drove. The damn thing went more like a death trap. AC wasn't working. It was in the fucking middle of summer. We were all melting by the time we got there. Jesus.
Ugh.
Then it fucking turns out the tattoo parlor in the other town closed down years ago.
Damn, how'd you end up getting your tattoo then?
Well, you see, the fucking thing was, that guy, I think Jenny said his name was Morse, just offhandedly said, oh, I used to be a tattoo artist back in my gang days.
Really?
Yep. And that's the story when I get a tattoo done by an ex-gang member. Might have cried a bit during the tattooing part. Teach probably took a bunch of embarrassing photos. I don't ask her for them.
I would never dream of it.
On the bright side, at least I got a cool shoulder tattoo just like Boss. Oh shit, customers are starting to come in now. I'll talk to you later.
Good luck. I clicked my phone shut with a smile just in time to hear the bell ring. Behind me, Philip slammed his book shut with a sigh of relief. One class down, there's three more to go. Four horribly long hours later, I was finally done. Today's class is all even worse than usual. Mrs. Curly is shooting me looks of disappointment. Why did you break curfew? You made me worry sick again, her face screamed during the entire class. Maybe I was just projecting again, who knows? With a sigh, I limped through the doorway and into the classroom like a kicked puppy.
Damn, you look horrible. Perked up with surprise. Jenny, weren't you banned from campus? I squinted. Damn, you look worse. Wow, my feelings. Jenny clutched her in melodramatic agony. It was true that her eyes looked unfocused with dark bags under her eye. Really? Okay. You could do that sentence a bit better. And was it just my imagination, or did she look thinner than usual? You feeling all right? You look a bit off. He scowled and waved her hand dismissively. Holy shit, for someone who went back and fixed the writing, you sure didn't fix the writing. I'm fine, just haven't been sleeping well. Anyway, do you know where the printer room is? Need help, sis, with a favor.
The printer room is next to Mr. Curlio's office, but why do you need it?
Well, I stopped by the cafe this morning to see how sis was doing, and damn, business was booming. Sis was just trying to make more promotional material and asked me to photocopy some posters for him in the printer room. So here I am.
Jenny suddenly smirked and leaned closer in a secretive whisper.
By the way, I saw Sissel's texture this morning. Did you two make it to third base?
That is none of your business.
Jenny snickered at me and congratulated Pat on the back. I don't mean anything by it, just happy to see you guys get along so well.
Well, they didn't. They actually didn't fuck, so I guess that dialogue is just the same either way, if you choose to just talk or, you know, choose to bone, whatever.
Uh-oh, here comes trouble. Philip, you're here too.
Unfortunately.
Good timing. I need an artist's opinion on this flyer Sizzle designed.
Not exactly a graphics designer, though. She began digging through her bag and pulled out a wrinkled piece of paper.
That's fine, you're a blunt asshole, which is exactly what this flyer needs.
Oh yes, yeah, someone who is blunt is automatically an asshole. Thanks a lot, Jenny. Fuck you too.
Wow. My feelings.
Well, it's true, dude. You are blunt. I appreciate that in person, so... I stood over Jenny's shoulder at the paper curiously. I'm sure just a flyer can't be that bad.
Well, never mind. I mean, the design wasn't bad, but it was about as impressive as getting socks for Christmas.
It is still usable?
You've been sleeping with him, Alex. Chirping doesn't count.
Touché.
Well, here's the flyer, Philip. Tell us what you think.
Jenny shoved the paper into Philip's hands with an expectant look. Philip turned the paper over and stared at her a solid minute, and then kept staring for another minute in silence.
Well,
is that Cran? Wow! Way to go against his fucking wishes, you fucking... I'm not sorry for this. That is a direct violation of his fucking privacy and what he told you about it. For fuck's sake, you know I didn't want to fucking keep that trophy. Fuck you.
Oh my god, I know I didn't want to keep that trophy, and this makes it even worse. Holy fuck.
Is that Cran? Probably. He spelled culinary wrong.
Yeah, I noticed that too.
Yep.
Why is there a drawing of a crab in the corner?
I think that's supposed to be Herschel, you know, Sissel's boss.
His my condolences. And pity. You guys can't spread this kind of flyer around. No one's gonna take it seriously. Here, give me a moment.
Jenny and I watched as Philip dashed off into the printer room with a face of pure disappointment.
Couple minutes went by before he walked out with a stack of fresh flyers.
Alright, how does it look?
Oh my god, okay. New design looked a lot more professional. Miles better than Sissel's hand-drawn scribbles, as adorable as they might be. Jenny nodded in approval.
A lot better. You can really save this one.
Oh, you got rid of Herschel's face.
Nobody likes seeing other people's faces. People are disgusting.
I love you, Philip. Holy shit. Also, still, this is not okay. This is not okay. I don't care. You're using something that is probably traumatic
to this dude, which I know is traumatic for him because I played this fucking game, but Sissel doesn't know that. He doesn't know I didn't want the fucking trophy, but no, let's just fucking put that fact all over the fucking posters. Totally, fuck you. Let's keep that design nice and simple to work out for the better. Then he took the stack of flyers from Philip and carefully placed them in a folder in her bag.
Well, it's another job well done. By the way, Sis said he wanted all of us to come to the cafe to see how things are improving. Y'all better come along. I heard he's been working really hard to improve the cafe's business.
Hey, I'm not complaining. I really want to try those new chocolate desserts anyway.
God, he still has this face on. Of course he does.
Well, I guess I have nothing better to do. Let's go.
Halfway on her walk to the cafe, Philip suddenly barked that he needed to pee real bad before dashing to the nearest convenience store like a madman. Maybe he shouldn't have drank 4 coffees during class today. Maybe he should sleep. Maybe he shouldn't have shouted so loudly because I was pretty sure that the neighborhood heard him. Jenny and I just shrugged and sat in a shady spot on the sidewalk, tapping our feet leisurely as we waited. That was until Jenny discreetly covered her mouth to muffle her harsh coughing again. Gave her a look of concern and gently patted her back as she continued coughing. Hey, Jenny, are you sure you're feeling all right? I'm getting worse lately and I'm a bit worried. She shook her head dismissively and scowled.
I'm fine, Alex. Just got a bit of a chronic cough, that's all.
You say so. The two of us sat awkwardly on the sidewalk in silence. Okay, I just gotta say, this is a completely different vibe to what I'm reading currently. My friend Matthew, he got me a copy of... He got me a book that is basically all of Montaigne's writing that we have current... That we have. Like, all of his essays, some travel journals he had, and some letters... So, like, this is a completely different vibe, but I still appreciate it, because it's, like, nostalgic for me, and I genuinely think it's at least somewhat good, or I wouldn't be fucking playing it. Because that's one thing you need to know about my channel, for those new. If I don't like a fucking VN, it goes bye-bye. End of story. Goodbye, the end. I don't care if it gets viewers go bye-bye. I don't care if it loses me, like, subscribers. If I don't like what I'm doing, fuck off. It's going bye-bye. End of story. Which is one of the reasons why Soul Creek is no longer a thing, because I hated the protagonist with the... I hated him so much. He was one of the dumbest pieces of shit I've ever had the displeasure of having to see a world from. See from... Like, good grief. And yes, I know you're going to say, oh, but try to view from his perspective. I did. Okay? And what he was not behaving in the way a rational person would behave. Okay? He wasn't. He just wasn't. It's Adastra syndrome, I tell you. It's Adastra syndrome. Fuck Adastra. Terrible game. Oh, there goes another 10 subscribers. Bye-bye. Have a nice life. Fuck you. Philip sure was taking his time with his pee break. Then he glanced at me a few times before gently clearing her throat.
Say, Alex, there's something I want to talk to you about.
What's up? Jenny laughed and shrugged.
It's no big deal. It's just that you've been a really good influence on Sissel lately, and I'm glad you were helping with stuff. Usually Sissel's always calling me, always anxious that he's doing something wrong in his life. It's been less of that ever since you two met. Nowadays, all he ever calls me about is asking for dating advice, and I always make people happy. It's nice. Glad you're here.
My face heat up as I smiled sheepishly. It's no big deal, we just get along really well, that's all. Jenny laughed, but there was a slight hint of sadness to it.
Speaking of which, I wanted to tell you I might be going on a trip soon.
A trip? What kind of trip?
Well, you know, a nice long vacation. I'll be gone for a long while, so I want you to keep an eye on Sissel for me. Make sure he doesn't do anything stupid or go on another moping trip while I'm gone.
I can't say anything. I can't say anything. For those who haven't seen it, fucking Christ. Denise turned with a soft smile on her face.
Take care of him for me.
Okay, so I'm not going to say anything. But those of you who are at least semi-observant and are, like, able to follow a train of thought enough, I'm pretty sure you guys understand what's going on here. I'm pretty sure you guys understand. There was an uncomfortable knot in my chest as I nodded quietly.
Of course.
I really should make these videos age-restricted, to be honest. But even if I did that, people still can fake their age on their Google account, so...
Yeah.
We sat quietly next to each other, the summer breeze brushing our faces relaxingly. Philip stomped out of the convenience store a few minutes later, huffing about the hygienics of public bathrooms. Ah, yes, me too. Me too, Philip. 100%. 100%. I don't use public bathrooms if I absolutely don't have to. Like, even if I genuinely really have to piss or go to the bathroom, I do not go in public bathrooms. I hold it. Fuck those things. Before we knew it, the three of us were strolling our way towards Urschel's cafe again as though nothing happened. There is a person in this... There is literally a person there. The cafe was buzzing with customers and activity when we stepped through the door. Stared around the dining area in shock. The place was packed. Thistle was rushing around the cafe at a frantic pace, his arms shuffling plates and drinks to all the diners with surprising efficiency. Maybe put efficacy there or something.
Hey guys, so glad you could all make it.
He waited excitedly for us to sit by the counter as he shuffled back into the kitchen with arms full of cutlery. Philip, Ginny, and I looked at each other before settling down to our seats. I sighed and stared at the kitchen door fondly.
Nice to see him all happy and energetic again.
He nodded in agreement.
Our little sissy is growing up.
He looks a little overworked if you ask me. Pot calling the kettle black, bitch. Kitchen doors swung open again and Philip scrambled out to meet with a static grin. Philip Sissel, Jesus Christ. Just seeing him so cheerful and full of life made my heart melt like butter. I don't know what it says there. Just look. Just look. I'm be lazy. Just let me be lazy. Damn it. Oh, yeah, just let me be lazy, damn it. Okay. NPC, expendable NPC. Oh, it's fucking funny. I love Philip. I love him so much. God. Art jumped into the beat when Sissel laid out several plates of chocolate desserts and drinks onto the counter.
So nice to see you all guys take the time to visit me.
Here's a few pastries for you all to try, free of charge. Boss insisted we get to treat you guys. Stirred the delectable chocolate pastry in front of me, a pool of drool starting to form in my mouth. Ew. Needless to say, I was already forking sweet and delicious bites of chocolate in my mouth before anyone else.
I'm in love.
Thank you, Captain Obvious. But seriously, sis, it's so nice to see you happy and hard at work again. So proud of you.
Sissel scratched the back of his head bashfully. He looks way skinnier than he does in the sprite art here. Which, I don't know, I prefer it that way.
Jeez, thanks, Mom. You're getting really mushy again.
Just being honest.
Well, just gave Sissel a nonchalant thumbs up.
You're done good.
A grin and enthusiastic thumbs up back. Philip was a little distracted from picking at his pastry with a fork with a quiet mumble.
Shouldn't waste a cake on me. Sugar is...
You made sure your pastry was real low in sugar, Philip. How you like it?
Philip looked intrigued. Tentatively scooped a small fork full of chocolate into his mouth before breaking slowly into a fond smile.
Thanks, Sissel. This is really sweet in the feelings kind of way.
Sissel beamed with utter pride.
It's my pleasure. I couldn't have done this without all you. Help me along. Now let's get the cafe run in tip-top condition and help Bosch the way I've always wanted. Hope he likes how things are turning out, too.
Sure, Herschel is prouder than ever.
Why do you wear your fucking outfit like this, dude? That's fucking weird.
Look at this place, it's packed. Everyone here is smiling and having a grand old time, thanks to you.
So blush sheepishly.
Well, I can't claim all the credit. Boss has been working hard in the kitchen, too. If business keeps going like this, we might be able to hire more workers and even help Boss pay out most of his debt real soon.
Ah, yes, this is too cheery, this is too happy, and I know it's coming. I know it's coming, and I know how it goes to fucking shit real fast. Boy, I know what happens here, and it eats me up inside. I know I can't change it. Until, well, you'll see.
No, speaking of which, did you guys print out the poster I asked for this morning?
Oh yeah, I've got them right here. Bill made some minor artistic adjustments, though.
Minor?
He changed the whole fucking design.
You need to dug out the packet of flowers that were back, which is received gratefully.
Oh, this came out super nice. I should get rid of the boss's picture, though.
I'll take a sip of coffee and sure.
Holy shit, another just sleep. Fucking sleep. Jesus.
Here's a mediocre fit. Wow.
Okay.
Oh, I heard that.
Orvis perked up at the sound of Herschel laughing jovially as he came through the kitchen doors.
How are your kids doing today? Glad to see you all drop by.
Hope you're all enjoying the new desserts. Sissy did a real good job with improving them in the cafe.
Place hasn't been this busy in years.
Oh boy. Am I gonna have to like change? I have a feeling. That would actually make a lot of sense though. I'd have to change his voice for more. Oh, whatever.
Herschel grinned and ruffled Sissy's hair proudly. Sissy flushed with a bashful look in his face.
Doing my best to keep you happy, boss. Thanks for having me.
Anytime, kiddo.
Herschel glanced at the flowers on the counter with interest.
Oh, are those the... Oh, no. This is what I was worried... This is what I was telling you about. Here comes the fucking... Honestly, the deserved outburst. Because this fucker... Not that I don't like Sissel. He has his own issues, and I understand why he did it. But at the same time, that's going against his fucking privacy. Obviously, he doesn't want people to know about it if he had the fucking thing locked in a fucking closet.
Oh, those little pamphlets you were going on about earlier. Yeah, I've been talking with the neighborhood a lot about the cafe, but I figure we should do more advertising.
She'll chuck in to pick up one of the flyers, reading through the writing in pretty colors. There it comes. I have to be angry. In that ridiculous voice. He reached the bottom of the page, and his proud smile instantly faded into a cold, hard frown. Made by the national culinary champion. His tone was bitter, borderline furious. He fidgeted with his apron nervously.
Boss? Where are you going on? We're going around telling everyone this.
She turned towards Sissel, his expression unreadable.
Yeah? Figured it'd be a nice way to attract more customers and whatnot.
There's someone behind us, an elderly couple, suddenly waved to Herschel enthusiastically.
Oh, Herschel, dear, why didn't you tell us about this national champion business? We've been dining here for years and never knew you were such an accomplished person until a little helper told us.
Herschel visibly flinched as though someone had carved him with a knife. Crushed the flower in his hand with bald fists and turned towards the cafe, gritting his teeth.
Get out!
His voice boomed the cafe, shaking every wall and fixture.
Everyone get out! We're closing early today. Forget about the bill. Everyone just get out!
Oh boy, yeah. Very deserved. Very reasonable reaction. To be completely honest, cafe was deathly quiet. People slowly began shuffling out of their seats and leaving out the door with frightened looks in their faces. Sissel, Jenny, Philip, and I watched in stunned silence as the cafe slowly emptied, leaving just the five of us. Sissel turned toward Herschel, shocked tears hanging on the edge of his eyes.
Boss, I don't understand.
Herschel growled frustration and covered his face with one hand.
Sissel, just... All of you leave me for today. I need some time alone.
Exchange nervous glances before quietly making her way towards the door. Sissel stood stunned. All of his effort and work to make Herschel happy just vanished in one moment.
Yeah, well, maybe if you didn't, I don't know, parade his fucking secrets to the world, this wouldn't be happening. But no, you had to be a nosy little prick.
Shook back a quiet sob.
Why?
She let up a hand, silencing him.
Just go!
Before stomping upstairs and out of sight. And waited Sissel sigh and gently took him by the hand. Sissel, squeezed back, hand shaking with hurt. Eyes were unfocused, staring off in the distance with tears welling up at the edges.
Yeah, I'm fine. Let's get going.
fucking sound constipated. They're not fucking crying. Jesus Christ. Four of us went off the cafe. She was staring at Sissel uneasily. Only made it halfway down the street before Sissel's knees gave out. Stopped at controlling on my shoulder, unable to even breathe properly as he clutched onto my jacket. Do little to comfort him besides sit together and hold him close. Four of us huddled on the sidewalk, looking to each other nervously as Sissel caught his breath. Sitting down, hunched over with his face in his hands. Tears ran dry about an hour ago, but it was still shaking. Light red and raw from his sobbing, but his breathing slowly evened out. He sat by his side, looking concerned and rubbing gentle circles on his back.
Hey, sis, you doing all right?
His spiteful laugh escaped his throat as he looked up to all of us, his voice still hoarse.
No. I don't know. I don't even know what's happened anymore. I tried so hard to don't just... put my face. Really am good for nothing. Shut up. No. No, 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 no. Don't go down this...
Sissel, listen, that's not true.
You're silent, but he stumbled before catching himself. Don't need you guys to beat me every time I fuck up. Just leave me alone. Need some time to think.
He said barely and stood up. The rest of us watched in uncomfortable silence as Sissel staggered down the street without giving us a second glance.
He's running off into the woods again, isn't he?
Can't just leave him by himself like this. Shouldn't we? Then he shook her head doubtfully.
I don't think Sis is really in the mood to listen to us right now. Give him some space to sort out his thoughts. Be there when he's open to it.
Then my jacket so hard it hurt. I think felt so helpless.
Well, what the hell are we supposed to do? So just hit rock bottom. I can't just leave him and do nothing.
Just on my shoulder. You know, my eyes with an understanding and equally frustrated expression.
We've been comforting him for the last hour, and now the best we can do is give him some peace and quiet.
Expression hardened.
We can't focus on figuring out what Sissel's, Herschel's problem is. Gotta be some sort of misunderstanding. Herschel really loves Sissel. There's gotta be a reason why he blew up like that.
We can show Sissel this isn't his fault, and there's other factors he's not seeing. This could be a good chance to mend things between them. Shoulders hung heavily as I stood up from the sidewalk.
At this point, I'm willing to do anything if it'll help. Count me in.
Then he smiled gratefully.
When does the scene happen? The scene is coming up, really. It's coming. The scene is coming. I know it's coming.
Thanks, Alex. Good idea where to start. Wait, where did Philip go?
Danced around the empty stream of watermen.
Oh, this is the scene. Okay, got it.
Swear he was just with us a few minutes ago. Our phones buzzed, and two of us simultaneously flipped open our messages. Text from Philip read. Sorry for running off, guys, but something urgent came up. No one hasn't been answering my call for the last 2 days, ever since he left school. Getting worried, so I'm leaving to go check on him. I'm sure you guys can handle this situation. You two are close to him anyway. You know if anything comes up. Philip grumbled and stuck my phone forcefully back in my pocket.
Timing sure is convenient.
Sure, Philip has his reasons. He's got a point, too. Too many people prying into this might make things difficult. Two of us should be able to handle it.
Say so. This looked irritated because he placed another gentle hand on my shoulder and nudged me down the street.
Come on, Alex. Don't let that frustration get the better of you. Let's go.
Oh, it's not that scene, then. Okay. A library.
Although this looks a lot more like a movie. So, you know, now that I think about it, it doesn't look bad at all.
This looks like a cool library, though.
Looks like a fun library to just look around and browse and take in the atmosphere. I mean, honestly. I'm honestly kind of like... I know, like, to some viewers, you're like, why is he so upset over a fucking library or whatever? I mean, they're basically, like, one of my comfort places, you know? Like, going into a bookstore or going into a library and just sitting there and reading, like, to an atmosphere of, like, how quiet it is and all that. And just the smell of the old book. It's just a lot, man. It's a very intense cocktail of memories and emotions for me, in a way. Whatever. My room was empty and cold as Jenny led me through the shelves. Glanced around the old bookcases warily, placed my legal paper and mothballs. Ah, there it is. There's that. There's... Yeah. I'm getting memories in my head right now. Remind me again why we're here. Shut the fuck up, doofus. The woman impatiently shifted through the old newspaper archives.
We're here because there's something fishy about Herschel and the way he's reacting to the whole national champion title. I want to know why. There's got to be a reason. Herschel is usually a real gentle guy. There's more to this than just a simple competition. I just know it.
Put my nose in the dusty shelves and sniffed. Clouds of dust watered. Jenny sifted through piles of old newspaper articles. Shame Herschel wasn't born during the age of the internet. It'll take forever to find what we need. Oh, shut the fuck up, dude. Wandered down the aisle and scanned the shelves by date. Competition Herschel attended happened around 18 years ago in August, wasn't it? It's a big-ass pile of newspaper to sort through. Sniffed a familiar cold chill down my spine.
They're in that corner to your left. It's like a lot of papers and tabloids were covering the event at the time.
Thanks, Ike. I'm glad I've still got my little helper goes with me.
Jesus fucking God, I hate it. 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 Nah, because I know what this means. I know why he's disintegrating, and it's because he's not carrying out the wish that he was meant to fulfill, and he doesn't want to fill out that wish because it would kill his wisher. So, yeah, dust fluttered to the air as Echo appeared beside me with a strained expression. Dude, are you doing okay? You look even worse you did yesterday.
Wisher slipped his way towards me.
Alex, I need you to listen closely. You're running out of time. I can feel the remedy getting close, and... Well, I'm not sure what will happen. Wait for your investigation here, okay? Let's do what I stole the perimeter in the meantime.
Go and stare at the empty space where Echo stood. Whatever was happening, we should probably hurry with our search. Glanced over my shoulder where Jenny was still sorting through her newspaper pile. Jenny, I found them over here.
Well, that was quick. Let's skim through a bunch of these and see what we can find. Kind of be hinted as to why Herschel was so mad about this competition.
Oh, there's a reason. And it's not really anger, it's more trauma, to be honest. It's more trauma and guilt. Which are way more potent than anger. Way more potent. Library clock ticked by as two of us shuffled through the stack of decade-old articles in an anxious rush. We scanned through newspapers, tabloids, advertisements, and magazines, or anything out of the ordinary but the culinary event. Press at the time painted Herschel as the rising undergod of the competition as Hyannon. Highlighted how he was a culinary prodigy, like his sister Celia Bradley. Sighed and tossed his newspaper into a red pile. You found anything useful yet?
Nothing that particularly sticks out. These are articles for pretty eager to compare to Celia's success, though. This shiny new finals is truly unto such a legendary legacy. I mean, it's probably irritating to constantly live in his sister's shadow, but it's nothing to throw a tantrum over. Herschel was doing really well for himself, too. He got to take a 5-hour flight across the country to attend the finals. Kind of curious what his sister was doing at this time. What did she spend her pride money on from their previous competition on?
That's a good question, and I know the answer. Great, mom's home. Fucking splendid. The dog's gonna start barking now. Because they always bark when she's here. And I want to just... I hate the dog so much. Read the article I tossed aside earlier, curiously. Well, according to this interview, Cecilia Bradley smushed her money supporting Herschel's education. It's very nice of her. The rest of it was spent fending off their parents' very illegal debtors who were constantly harassing them after their parents' deaths. Just rolled my eyes as I glanced over the gossip section of the tabloid. This says Cecilia tried to marry a rich gentleman from a nearby city, but it didn't work out. Sorry to remind me why I never like reading celebrity gossip. I had to skip over the part where Cecilia was called a gold-digging hag and moved on. Two of them had broken up the year before Herschel's competition.
Is Cecilia alone to take care of the baby with her? She'll dropping out of college to help support her. Jenny's eyes widened. She nearly jumped out of her seat to grab him at the shoulder.
The baby? What happened to the baby?
Shuddering through the tabloid anxiously. Didn't mention anything more about Cecilia's child. John's article sign grabbed another one. Well, let's see. None of the gossip mags mentioned much about it, surprisingly.
Didn't more say Cecilia was murdered? Read a local crime section or something.
Now that you mentioned it, a local newspaper headline caught my eye.
This says that...
I gulped. Dates towards the end of Herschel's championship contest. Cecilia and her baby were confronted by her parents' debtors. They got unruly after finding out she presumably didn't have any money. Police searched Cecilia's cabin in the woods and found signs of struggle. The place was stripped of all valuables. It's presumed that she and the baby were both killed and thrown to Bradley Lake. Their bodies were never recovered. Well, technically.
Technically?
A little sick as I read further. They found one of Cecilia's fingers floating in the lake a few weeks later. The fisherman even reported to see a crow flying around with one of her scavenged eyeballs. Besides that, nothing. How would they know it was her? I guess they did some forensics or something. Fucking Christ. Jenny covered her mouth and looked a little green.
Oh, that's unfortunate. Just figure maybe she lost a baby and this is an orphan who shit up out of nowhere, you know?
I get what you're saying. Sharp pains only crackled through my chest. The air left my lungs and I dropped to my knees, gasping for air.
What was that sound? Alex? Alex, are you feeling all right?
I squeezed shut, teeth gritting tightly. Jenny held me back on my feet. The world felt like it was spinning wildly. My head hurt.
I don't know. Did you hear that, though?
He nodded slowly but looked doubtful. She glanced around the library. Nobody else in the building seemed reacting to it. Everyone kept their noses buried in the books as though the thunderous crack from moments ago never happened. So what's she doing?
Sound like it from outside.
Strutting my legs steady, my chest still burning with a stabbing pain.
I'm gonna check it out. Maybe you should go to rest first. You don't look so good. Hey, Alex, wait!
Oh, boy. Yes, it looks like the remnants using Zoworldo again. I see. Sprint outside with Jenny falling close behind. Pain made the world spin sporadically as I stumbled onto the sidewalk.
Glad to see you could make it, Alex.
Where was it? Like the sweat dripping down my brows, I struggled to see where the voice was coming from. Voice, that was my voice. I was speaking with my own voice. Oh, okay. What are you doing to me?
Alex, look.
Grotesque shards of glass were scattered across the pavement. There was a shattered camera lying upon the grass. Then the sickening realization hit me. Those were Echo's remains. Jesus fucking Christ, man. Nodding sound of crunching bone reverberated through my skull as the remnant gnawed his way towards the left of Echo's arm. Straight at me with its inhumane eyes and grinned through its meal. Finally. So tired of feeling empty. And my own voice coming out of that creature's mouth was nothing short of terrifying. Another sharp pain crackled within my chest and I fell to my knees. Ran to my side on my back and my feet, looking bewildered.
Is that the same faceless thing that helped me get the phone a couple of days ago?
And it tipped its head towards me with a grin.
Yes. And now I can finally give Alex what he truly wishes for.
That old hag in the lake can't hold me back. And it crouched down, its back suddenly lurching and bubbling as though something was trying to claw out of it.
Okay. Yeah. Neat.
Suddenly, a mass of tendrils burst out of its back like maggots from a cocoon.
Okay.
Tendrils shaped into dozens of grotesque hands, each clawing hungrily at the air. Remnant tilted its head and stared towards me. A single violet eye in its head rolled in its socket to peer intensely into me. I will make your wish reality no matter how many times it takes.
You would have to repeat this wretched world over and over and over again.
Pod lifts his head as though to sniff the air in search of something. It's time and looks a lot to focus on him. I stood in stunned silence, learning to abruptly disappear before our eyes. For a few moments, I stumbled forward and anxiously reached for the shards of echo that were scattered across the pavement. They crumbled into dust, and once my fingers touched them, a sense of dread gnawed at my chest as I watched the dust scatter in the air.
He's really gone.
The pain in my chest continued to ache as the feeling of my wish slowly faded away. Now there's only an empty numbness inside. Jenny knelt down next to me and wrapped a comforting arm around my shoulder.
I'm not sure what just happened, but are you doing okay?
Pressed again on my chest and squeezed my eyes shut.
I'm not sure. Everything just hurts now. I don't mean to scare you even more. What was that thing talking about? Whatever it was, it sounded very good.
I'll have to focus on him. Jenny and I looked at each other for a split second before simultaneously coming to the same conclusion. Cecil.
Lots of shit. Lots of fucking shit here. Holy hell. Oh, okay. Okay, so, yeah. As I have said multiple times now, the wish that brought Echo into existence was Alex wishing that he was dead. I'm guessing. We haven't really confirmed that, but it's abundantly clear to me that was what he wished for. At 6 years of age, no less. And because Echo didn't want that wish to happen, it festered and festered and festered, and suddenly now we have the remnant. Which, man, not to mention the fact that who knows how many times this cycle has happened at this point. Who knows how many cycles they've been through. I mean, I don't even want to think about that, honestly. It's the worst kind of fucking existential terror, honestly. Cecil wandered down the cold trail of Bradley Woods while glaring intently at his feet. It seemed like he was always found himself back here to this lake whenever his life took an awful turn. He sighed and rubbed his sore eyes again, his eyelids still raw from sobbing over an hour straight. There were no tears left, just exhaustion. Cecil sat nearby a log and buried his face in his hands. He was glad Jenny and Alex went around to baby him this time around, but the woods felt a little colder without them fussing over him. He didn't deserve their help anyhow. Even when he tried his best to make things right, everything took a turn for the worst, making a mess wherever he goes. Parents didn't want him, and now even Herschel didn't want him. Okay, buddy, you're making some vast assumptions, but whatever. Maybe he really was worthless. No, that's not true. You know that's not true.
Alex, I told you to leave me alone.
So Chandra looked around in confusion.
Oh god, this art. I know, oh fuck, I know what happened. Ugh.
No one else around. It was just him. Alone in a log in the forest.
This gives me big My Neighbor Totoro vibes.
Thistle sat up straight, his hair standing on end.
Alex, is that you? Not really in the mood for pranks.
I never joke about something so important. You doing all right? You're not looking too good.
Thistle scowled and rolled his eyes.
Not gonna talk to him, it feels like hiding and playing games.
Alright, I'm coming out.
Forest air hissed as something appeared sitting on the log next to him. Yeah, major Totoro vibes right now.
The fuck?
So Jump nearly toppled off his seat in shock.
Don't be afraid, I'm just a friendly neighborhood spirit. Ghost thingy. Dave and I'm not sure about the details.
Gave to the strange creature mumbling on the log next to him. First instinct was to run the hell out of there, but there was something about it that felt strangely familiar. Go up before staring at its terrific face closely.
Hate to break it to you, but you look anything but friendly.
Hey, I didn't want to be born this way. This is just how Alex made me. Thistle blinked.
Alex made you into this?
Just shrugged awkwardly, just believe. Depression is an ugly thing. I don't blame him. Speaking of depression, Link tilted its head towards him at a strange angle. Thistle felt its empty eye sockets, examining him carefully. You don't sound too good. My parents didn't want me. Herschel didn't want me. Thistle's stomach lurched painfully.
Stop doing that!
I make a mess wherever I go, whatever I do. Maybe I really am worthless.
Shut up, get out of my head!
Tripod and gave him a soft smile with its crooked mouth. You know you're being unfair to yourself. Herschel doesn't hate you, and neither did your parents.
Heck, you don't even know your parents.
They could be the sweetest people in the world, for all you know. Crossed his arms and stared at his feet uncomfortably.
Why'd they leave me in a dumpster, then?
Creature's smile faltered, and it hung its head down in silence.
Herschel, I did everything I could to help him out, but he just...
Someone held sharply inside.
Here I am. I tried my damn best, but nobody wanted her, me.
Creature stared at him quietly for a moment before speaking again. Everyone is fighting their own battles. I know that Herschel loves you very much, but he's also dealing with a lot of guilt. And as for your parents, I've no doubt your mother loved you very much, too. Thistle looked up at it sharply.
How do you know that? You're just a thing.
Shadowy entity laughed softly and hopped onto its feet. In that case, I'll just have to show you. Follow me.
Wait!
I really don't like voicing this thing with my voice, you know? Like, I don't like doing the voice I do for Alex for this thing. Even though narratively it makes fucking sense, man. It makes so much sense. Thistle gaped and watched as the creature limped quietly down the forest trail and disappeared. Something told him that he shouldn't follow strange creatures into strange places. You mean your logic? You mean your fucking animal instincts crying out to be listened to? Maybe you should listen to them. Hell, he could just be hallucinating all this after crying so much earlier today. But that thing mentioned knowing something about his parents, mother. Thistle took a deep breath and stood up. He knew Bradley would lick the back of his hand anyway. Saw him and taken a look. Thing that called itself the Remnant. It's a depressing name. They also just call me Remy or something. Remy, okay. Led him to a familiar sight in the woods. Creature beckoned him excitedly before ducking into the ruined cabin's low door frame. Thistle followed with a doubtful frown. He's lived in this broken down cabin for most of his life and familiar with almost everything in here. What was this Remy trying to show him? He began digging around a dark corner of the cluttered room like a dog scavenging for a treat. Bits of rotting wood were flung in the air. Thistle flicked away a wood chip stuck in his fur before peering over Remy's shoulder curiously. Creature suddenly gurgled triumphantly through a mouthful of wood. Ha! Here we are. Thistle started to see Remy stand up with his scratched up VHS tape in its mouth. Grinned at him before dropping it into his hands. Thistle wrinkled his nose at the spit-covered tape and wiped it on his pant leg.
What is this supposed to be?
Do you not know what a VHS is? Man, kids these days. Still held the smelly tape at arm's length and scowled.
Didn't exactly grow up in a technology-filled household. Am I supposed to stick it in TV or something?
Creature nodded its head, almost to say, well, duh.
Doubt this old thing works anymore. Where would I even find a VHS player around here? The tech junk in this cabin is broken to hell and back anyway.
Remy laughed and drop-tapped its leg on the wooden floor excitedly. That's not a problem. Thistle gaped in astonishment. The edge surface of the tape shifted and renewed itself right under his fingertips. Pieces of the smashed-up television sat on the cottage floor, scuttled together like ants returning to a colony. Shards of plastic and metal slid into place and formed what looked like a brand-new TV. That's not brand-new. Thistle ran his hands across its surface, mesmerized.
Wow, you can make things, like, new again. This whole thing has been lying in the corner for years. It's kind of weird seeing it in one piece.
Don't mention, I mean, I get he didn't mention One Piece, but god, the anime, I'm never watching it. Never. Way too fucking long. Remnant tapped the TV with its chin and the old static screen flickered to life. Play that tape, you'll find what you're truly looking for in its contents. Thistle hesitated, feeling rather apprehensive. What was he looking for? Tape in his hands, and they felt very frightening. Then again, what did he have to lose? Hirsch already hate him for his fuck up, and he was back in this muggy old cottage. Thistle took a deep breath before inserting the tape into the VHS set and pressed the play button. Fuck. Fuck, 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 fuck. The screen shuddered and shook as gears in the television clicked into place and groaned to life. Thistle stared intently as the static rolled by, trying to make out something in the mess of shapes.
Amra. What?
Thistle perked up as at the sounds of a young but familiar voice.
Is this thing woken?
Thump.
Herschel, don't hit it. You're going to break the damn thing.
Stag at the screen suddenly cleared itself, all by a triumphant shout.
Ah, I golded the work through, didn't I? This is all fine.
Fuck. So cute. Smile for the camera, sis. Called me Mirror Woods for a brand new mom.
Julia Bradley stared awkwardly into the camera while busying herself with the small baby in her arms. Looked fatigued but happy as she gently rocked her arms into the rhythm, I guess.
Look, it's a baby. Made it myself.
Herschel snorted as the camera zoomed in on the baby's face. He cooed softly as the baby sniffled quietly at the noise.
He's so cute. How's an ugly old lady like you make such an adorable kid?
Gorgeous, thank you very much, and so is my kid. Obviously he gets all his good traits from me, after all, his father.
There was abruptly silent, her shoulders shaking into a tired slump. Marshall lowered the camera slightly and reached over to pat her back.
Hey, sis, you alright? I know you're still going through some shit. An asshole dumped you at the worst time possible.
Oh. Baby son let her smell sweet and reached his tiny hands to hold Cecilia's fingers to comfort her. His hands looked ridiculously tiny in comparison. Cecilia's eyes softened and she brushed her with his head softly for kissing him on the nose.
Aren't you the sweetest thing?
Dubbed Herschel with a soft, bittersweet smile.
He's so precious, isn't he?
Blair's cracked for a moment and she closed her eyes tightly.
Herschel, I'm scared.
I'm scared of what?
Of this. Being a mom. And where her parents were. I don't even know how a real mom's supposed to act. What if I mess this up? So the guy deserves better than what we got.
Room was silent for a long minute. Cecilia lowered her gaze to the floor apprehensively. She looked so distraught as this had been plagued her mind for a while. She cleared his throat and hummed thoughtfully under his breath.
Well, I don't know much about good moms. You've been a real good sister.
She laughed awkwardly, and Cecilia couldn't help but smile a little as well.
You pretty much single-handedly rescued me from that hell house and raised me into a decent, I think, person.
Ingle do fine with their own kid.
And you care, you love him so much.
So little guy will be happy that he was a mummy. He gently brushed her over his head a little more reassured.
Thanks, Hirsch. Probably messed up a few times, but I'll do my best to give him a better childhood than we ever had. He'll be a bumpy robot, I wouldn't trade this for anything. Do everything I can to raise him to be the happiest boy in the world.
I
Little baby yelled in response and stood closer to his mom. His determination in her eyes, she held him close and hummed contentedly into his ear. There's no doubt that she would do her child justice and probably spoil him, silly. Herschel's chuckle broke through their quiet, happy moment. I can't believe my uncle now. I'm starting to feel old.
Shrub doesn't pick up any of your bad habits as lazy as he grows up. Can barely do with one of you.
Uncle Herschel will be the funniest uncle you ever have. Don't get ahead of yourself. You still haven't named the little guy yet. You've been procrastinating on that for months. Ilya spluttered nervously.
Not good with names. How do parents even decide what to call their kids? There are too many options. You keep telling me ideas are dumb.
Stop trying to name your kid after cakes, sis. No, you're a baker and all, but there's no way in hell I'm gonna teach my nephew his tiramisu.
What?
Or eclair, or Swiss, or sponge. Especially not fucking sponge. Celia mumbled aggressively to herself.
It's a good cake.
Your child is not a cake. Please take this seriously. Cecilia paused, quiet for a few long moments as she gently brushed her child's hair. Her eyes suddenly lit up and she grinned.
Sissel.
Sissel. Herschel rolled the word off his tongue as though testing how it sounded. Cecilia Sissel. That's just her own name with a little L added to the end.
So grow up to be a lovable beauty like his mom. What's so wrong with that?
Fucking Christ. VHS tape spluttered as static started fogging to the screen again. Cecilia's voice could still be heard whispering softly to her newly named child.
I love you, Sissel. No matter what happens, just know that I'm so happy to have you with me. Hope I can be good mom to you.
Television powered down with a low whine as the video ended. Cottage was quiet and still. Tears slowly fell from Sissel's cheeks and landed on his hands and lap like little raindrops. He sniffed, shoulders shaking as he tried to collect himself. Celia Bradley's warm voice still echoed in his head as she slowly wiped his eyes.
Mom.
Sissel's heart lurched against his chest. All this time he thought his parents never cared for him. All those years he spent wandering the streets and feeling like unwanted trash. This time he had a mother who held him with such warmth and love. Mom, this felt like such a foreign word to him, but it was also something he desperately longed for. So he clutched his arms close to his chest and sobbed quietly to himself, alone in this abandoned cottage. Years of frustration, pain, and longing suddenly flooded out as he cried and cried and cried.
Yeah, I know I said it before, but now we're really getting to the parts that made me love this game. Now we're really getting to the parts that made me love this game. Just the absolute emotional clusterfuck that this game can be. It's so fucking good. It took a while before he felt steady enough to stand up again. Sun was already falling low on the horizon when Sissel stepped outside the cabin's rotting door frame. Remy followed him outside and glanced at him curiously.
Are you feeling all right?
Yeah, I'm still processing it all. It's a lot to take in.
It was still a mess of feelings he couldn't quite make sense of. Everything just felt heavier. Sissel sighed.
It's just... when I see my mom and Herschel being so happy in that video, I can't help but think, why am I not there? I should be with them, together, happy with my family. Still alone in the woods. Don't grow up on the streets without a home.
Claude's chest and frustration inside. That video of his mother felt like such a fantasy.
Wish I was there.
What have you done? What have you done? What have you done?
No, what have you done? I know where your mother is. I can take you to her. Fuck you. Remnant grinned and suddenly disappeared in the forest trail. Follow me.
Wait up! Is this another ghostly, life-changing discovery, or because I'm not sure if I'm ready?
Thistle panicked slightly at the realization the creature was nowhere in sight. With a sigh, he took off running down the forest trail towards Bradley Lake. Thistle skidded to a stop at the lake's edge to find the creature staring out in the open water. Followed its gaze curiously, but there was only the gentle waves of Bradley Lake lapping in the afternoon air.
What are you looking at?
There's something in the water. Something you have to see for yourself.
Creature waved its head in a beckoning gesture.
Come on, follow me. I'll show you.
Sissel only stared, perplexed. The creature began walking straight into the water and slowly disappeared beneath the surface.
But I don't think this is a good idea. I mean, I can't even swim. I'll probably fall over and drown or something.
And chuckled, his voice echoing through the quiet forest air.
Don't worry, I'll catch you. Water's only waist deep anyhow. Come on. You have to see this for yourself. Said you wanted to know what happened to your mother, didn't you?
Did, but this doesn't seem...
Cecil hesitated, staring at the dark waters apprehensively. What would this even accomplish? And again, this ghost thing did help him find the answer he was looking for before. The sigh, Sissel kicked off his shoes and socks to Lake Sandy Shore, or reluctantly wading into cold water. Water was chill to the touch. Sissel winced as he carefully stepped further out in the lake, his shorts getting soaked and cold. True to its word, the water was only waist deep here. So felt dumb and kicked around the lake mud, feeling through the water through the wet dirt and branch with his toes.
What exactly am I supposed to be looking for here?
Paused, the anxiousness rising when nobody responded.
Hello, ghost, are you still there?
Only silence. Just swore quietly under his breath and continued kicking around the lake but aimlessly. The damn ghost was gonna ditch him like this. He might as well. On his toe, pressure against something hard and cold in the water. Once he was saw by the tree branch, something about it felt strange, out of place in this lake. Thistle took a deep breath before crouching down and fishing blindly in the muddy water.
So here we go.
Flash of light made his heart jump in his chest. Out from the dark water was the long, silvery bone of an adult femur. Thistle immediately felt very nauseous.
What is this? Is that a femur of my mom?
Realization hit him like a truck. Clamped his mouth as he felt sick threatened to creep up his throat.
This is what you wanted to show me. This can't mean what I think. There's got to be something else. Why did you...
Water suddenly erupted with dozens of dark, disembodied arms. Lake water spread everywhere as tendrils slid through the waterways like a mass of serpents. Remnant's cackling was unbearably loud as Sissel felt countless hands roughly grabbing at every part of them. Part of them they could reach. Couldn't even scream before the arms dragged him down beneath the water's surface. Completely helpless, Sissel could do nothing as he felt himself being dragged deeper and deeper into the depths of Bradley Lake. Then there was nothing, only black. We have now reached the part of the VN where I first had to wait for an update. So that means you are going to have to wait for an update as well. So I hope you enjoyed this video in whatever capacity you can. Enjoy a video like this, and thanks for watching, everybody. I guess I'll see you in the next one, whenever that is.